One British family is volunteering to go back in time. Their destination, an ordinary home during the dark days of the Second World War.
This country is at war with Germany.
Here they will face the hunger.
These are our carrots.
Sod it!
The uncertainty.
Oh God, we've nothing else to eat. Knew this a bloody hand.
The day-to-day hardships of millions of British civilians living through the war on the home front.
Is he still on the toilet?
You get the children, I get the bedding.
It's been magical history tour. Every day has brought more surprises.
The 1940s house was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
In this London suburb, 11 miles from Buckingham Palace, many still remember the Battle of Britain being fought overhead. But it's the civilian experience of war rather than the military one that brings us here. Over the next 9 weeks, we'll be finding out how ordinary people survived the years of conflict and paying tribute to the courage they brought to the war effort. Today, 17 Braemar Gardens looks like many other semi-detached homes in the London suburbs, but it's about to become a time machine. Inside and out, all traces of the 21st century are being removed. This won't be a film set or museum, but a fully functioning home, equipped just as it would have been in pre-war Britain. A modern family is coming to live here for 9 weeks. Like the family who lived here in wartime, they'll have no phone, car, refrigerator, or television.
This is the perfect middle-class home of the 30s. Really a very nice home. I've had to pull it all back together again. Bringing all the things they need, from the cooker down to the toothbrush, everything that a home needs.
Over 300 families applied to travel back to live in wartime.
Hello, we're the Holloway family.
Hello, we're the Solomides family.
We're the Granger family.
We're the Labar family.
I want to be able to smell the smells. I want to be able to use the everyday items that normal people use.
It's that feeling of living on the edge. As well, of having to survive.
How did they feed their animals? I mean, do you get to such a stage where you look at the dog because you're getting hungry?
After a 5-month search, we found the perfect family.
I personally would like to do this project because my husband, throughout our marriage, has had, I think, an obsession with the 1940s. As you'll see, perhaps from the room, he would like to step back in time. It has been his boyhood dream.
I have a very deep interest in the 1940s, particularly the home front during the wartime period and the hardship and rationing and everything else that went with it and austerity. Not an obsession, as Lynn's just said.
It's not just this room. Your drawers upstairs are stuffed full of every kind of...
That's a
personal.
Healthy interest, it's not an obsession.
Oh, Kirsten.
All the books in the attic are...
He has a floor 40s. Full of books about it
the
in the attic.
With the job of restoration now well underway, the 1940s house begins to reveal the secrets of its own wartime story.
We bought this house because it was on the market. Then we had the survey done. We discovered there was some bomb damage to the back of the house.
I was searching under the stairs and I found a black bag. And inside the black bag, I found this
family Bible, which looked quite old and quite interesting. And inside, I found a note which read, "This Bible was left under the stairs of 17 Brymar Gardens by the widow of George Dixon, who died as a result of a heart attack following the efforts to put out a firebomb in the back garden in 1942. It ties in very nicely with the period and everything, and it's just extremely interesting to find such a piece of history. Dun, 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 dun.
Three generations of the Hymers family from the north of England will be our time travellers.
Was it steady?
Michael, an engineer. His wife, Lynn. Their daughter, Kirsty, a divorcee, and her sons, Ben, who's 10, and 7-year-old Thomas. The Hymers' journey back to wartime Britain begins with radical haircuts.
Have you ever heard of a haircut called a pudding basin?
Well, that's what you're going to have, boys, because that's the way it was in those days.
While the Hymers are being groomed for their wartime experience, the 1940s house garden is also being transformed. The wartime government needed people at home to produce their own food. Flower beds gave way to vegetable plots all over the country as Britain responded to the call to dig for victory.
What we've set out to achieve is to take the garden back to the late 30s and 40s, the wartime garden. Now, today we're encouraged to enjoy our gardens as an extension of the house, but for leisure and pleasure. But in the wartime, it was very much about, it was going to feed the larder in the kitchen with fruit and veg, and that was very important. Have a look at the cabbage. Now, it's a very old variety called Flower of Spring. Now, the qualities of that one is that the wartime gardener would have used all the leaves. They were not wasteful. We are wasteful people today. We pick the best. But they made the best of what they had. So all those big leaves on the outside, that would have been harvested and used as greens. I think one of the most valuable things were the onions. Many onions were imported, but in wartime, no imports. So the onions were very important. At the top of the garden, they're going to find some new inhabitants, some rabbits. And in the library, they're going to find this book. So I wonder how the rabbits will fare.
At home in the north of England, the Hymers family are finally ready for their journey back to the 1940s.
Come in then. Wherever you are. Oh! Oh,
the time has come for the family to say goodbye to friends and neighbours and embark on the journey south to their new wartime home.
As I came out of the door, I realised that this was it now, that I couldn't turn back. There were too many people involved and all the wheels had been set in motion, and here we go, for better or worse, as it were.
Thank you, everybody. Mm. Thank you.
This is what I imagine was the hardest thing for the people who lived through the war, people saying goodbye. It must have been so, so hard.
At the outbreak of war in September 1939, 2.25 million British citizens had to pack up and leave their homes. They didn't know if they would ever return.
Ben was acting grown up and trying not to let it, you know, bother him, but Thomas did actually get quite upset. I can't even begin to imagine what it must have felt like to, you know, wave your husband off or even wave your children off, but people had to do it.
On arrival at the 1940s house, the Heimers are greeted by Marguerite Patton, an authority on wartime food and lifestyle.
Hello. I'm here just to show you into your new home. Can you get this? I say, that's a splendid breach. Right, do come in. There we are.
Here at number 17, Braemar Gardens, the clock has been wound back to the day war was declared.
Now, you'll be the first person to go into your new home.
All three generations of the Heimers family have never lived together before. The 9 weeks in the 1940s house look set to test them on all fronts. Outside, the world might have moved on. But in here, everything is just as it was in wartime Britain, when danger was never far away.
That is your own siren. That is the one which will warn you of an air raid. And when it sounds, please, and this is terribly important, get moving quickly. I've worked out your first week's menus in 1939. That is a typical menu of what we would have had and cooked for a family.
Yes, it's chocolate cake. I can't make a cake.
I'm sure you can. No Yorkshire woman that's born who can't make a cake. Am I right? I bet she's good.
For 29 years, I've never known her to bake a cake.
Ah, well, then you'll have to explore the possibilities. I've never seen two ladies look so horrified.
Well, it's been very pleasure to meet you all, so I think we might have to get in touch with you.
Well, I think we've got a splendid family. They're ready to work hard, and by Jove, we worked hard during those years. The family haven't quite the same emotional problems, people in danger and worrying all the time about the news, but they have the other problems of making do. And they've suddenly stepped from a life where they had all their labour-saving appliances to a life where we really didn't have them. We had support from everyone around us, but they're doing it all by themselves.
Which is ours, do you think?
I don't know. This looks like the boys' room.
Is this ours?
Yes, it's ours. It must be. It's twin beds.
I've always had an interest in the home front during the 40s and often wondered what it would have been like to have lived through that time. So this is a bit of a dream come true, really.
Well, you've hit the jackpot.
Yeah.
Whether I'll still feel the same in 8 or 9 weeks, I don't know.
It won't be too bad. We can move these together.
No, I don't want to. Oh, wonderful. Is this your bedroom?
Yeah. Twin beds.
Yes!
When she's snoring, I'll push her over there.
They don't know it yet, but life for the Heimers in the 1940s house will be strictly controlled. There's a war on, and they're going to feel the impact of a strong government. To recreate the strict wartime regime, we have established a committee of scientists and historians to be our war cabinet and dictate the terms by which the family will live. Their headquarters will be the bomb-proof bunker of Winston Churchill's war rooms, now a museum.
During the Second World War, civilians in Britain came more under government control than they ever had before. In fact, this was probably the most controlled nation outside the Soviet Union. Now, let's start with the big question. How do we set about giving this family an authentic experience of wartime life?
As the cabinet, we're going to have to say there were regulations, there were rules from authority that governed your life in wartime, and these are going to have to govern your life too. You're not going to be able to have consultation. Rationing is going to affect you. Various emergency powers are going to affect you. And this is how you're going to have to live.
Let's get their neighbours denouncing them to the air raid precautions people. Let's get them fined. Let's see the psychological impact of the war on the home front.
I'm here because it's a challenge for me. I'm a person that lacks in confidence, so I think it's going to make me a stronger person. And because I live on my own, it's going to make me be able to cope with things better at home.
Oh, this is a nice room, isn't it?
Single bed, Kirsty, so you can't have any visitors.
You won't get many GIs in there.
We've got a window, we've got a room that locks.
Won't get a GI through there.
you back a bit.
Pregnant! It says? It says youngsters will be ready in approximately 6 to 8 weeks.
Hang on, how many rabbits have we got?
Five
rabbits? And how many? And one of them's with child?
Yeah. Granny, what are we having for tea?
So, this is cooked meat, eh?
Food rationing was introduced in 1940. But for their first week, the family are allowed a taste of pre-war cookery. Using their 1940s cookery book, they make a typical dish of the time, mincing cooked beef to make rissoles. The early war diet was rich in fat and carbohydrate, and the average daily intake was 3,000 calories, 1,000 more than is recommended today.
Now, that's going to take a few days to set on the full marble shelf.
There, perfect.
Right. I'm impressed with myself with that. That's the first time I've ever done that.
Having been a full-time working mother for 15 years or so, I relied totally on prepackaged foods or takeaways or restaurant meals. It was just easier because I never had time. The thing with the wartime housewife is she never had time, but she makes time. And that's what I'm going to have to learn to do.
Do you want any green salad?
Did you get this from the vegetable, Adam?
No, I did not today.
And I had to do it with my hands.
Mum?
What?
It's absolutely gorgeous. It's gorgeous.
Me too. Compared to what I normally have, the results were really nice. Better than any takeaway, better than anything Granny would get from packets. It was nice. I like homemade meals.
The Heimers should make the most of these early meals. When shortages kick in, food like this will be a rare luxury, if available at all.
So if you want to try that blancmange, tell me what it's like.
Ben?
Mum's rabbit blancmange is really nice. It was creamy and light and just... It was hardly there. You could hardly feel it when you put it in your mouth. It was just perfect.
This is London. The government have given instructions for the closing of places of entertainment. They are being closed because if they were hit by a bomb, large numbers would be killed or injured. Keep off the streets as much as possible.
The radio will be a vital link to the war years. Every day, the family will receive an hour of original BBC broadcasts.
Carry your gas mask with you always.
Early on, the government urged civilians to prepare for war, although it would be 6 months before bombs actually started to fall.
Make sure you and every member of your household have on them their names and address clearly written.
It's the family's first night in the house, and Lynn discovers that her 1940s beauty regime is not only time-consuming, but unrewarding.
It was lovely going to bed in the house because we put our lovely nighties on, and we spent another hour doing our putting our curlers in.
How could it take so long to look this ugly?
I mean, celibacy is the order of the day because I don't feel like a woman. And Michael didn't fancy his granny, so perhaps at 50 you were done for. You just crawled into your twin bed and died.
Terrible problem with these dresses.
They're a bit stiff, aren't they?
Are you making a drink?
What?
Are you making a drink? You're looking beautiful. Do you think it's
worth it?
Day two, and so far everyone's in good spirits. Michael's taking a break from work and the boys are on school holidays, giving the family time to adjust to their wartime lifestyle. Already, there's a problem with the rabbits.
There was two shy ones, and there was a mother one that was pregnant.
The family have been provided with rabbits to fatten up for food in the lean times ahead. However, some members of the family have no stomach for rabbit farming.
Rabbit keeping for food?
Yeah, the problem is you're thinking now, look...
Of course we're thinking of now. We're a family from now. The children are being brought up.
Exactly, so that's the point.
Every other house where I live has got rabbits in the back garden.
Anna, yeah. Everything you eat, meat-wise, and we are meat-eaters...
Yeah,
but they're not enough. They're not enough.
All right, we've got five puppies out there and we stew them.
No, I'm missing the point.
Wait, that's a breeding centre. It's distasteful, it's disgusting, and I can't live with it.
That's how it would have been.
We don't have to discuss it anymore. The rabbits are going today. Even if I have to walk.
I'm not advocating keeping the rabbits at all. I agree totally.
Pin them all up the street saying, rabbits, come and get them free. Give the address out or whatever. The rabbits are going.
Before the children get too attached to them.
The government was actively encouraging people to keep rabbits for food. Domestic rabbit clubs were springing up all around the country, and people were even offered extra rations of concentrated rabbit food to encourage them to keep and to breed the rabbits.
A lot of people kept rabbits, and then when the crunch came, decided that they couldn't bear to kill them, or I know instances of people actually killing a rabbit and then finding they couldn't eat it, even when it was on the table, and or sitting there eating it with tears streaming down their cheeks. And I think actually this family were rather sensible in anticipating the problem they were going to face when the ghastly moment came of having to kill the rabbit.
Right, let's do the business.
I need some rabbit food.
I wondered if you'd be interested in taking some rabbits off our hands.
How many of them are there?
There's four quite young.
Yeah.
One big rabbit. We're prepared to give you anything we've got to take them. Please take our rabbits.
They sell the rabbits.
Oh, you're upset something. About that, Tom?
Yes, what? Very.
Well, you're the easy one. Wait till we go tell your brother.
Rabbits were not the only pets to suffer. In the first 4 days of war, 400,000 Londoners had their cats and dogs destroyed. They feared they might not be able to feed them or keep them calm when bombs began to fall.
Sad when the rabbits went because I got nice and friendly with them, picking them up and cuddling them. They were so cute. We even named them. So I was sad when they went because I knew we wouldn't have another rabbit again. And Annie, why did she want to get rid of them?
It's happily resolved for us all. The rabbits have gone off to a good home. The pet shop man's delighted with his bundles. And the children are happy and we're happy. So, on to the war.
As well as a 1940s house, we've also provided the Heimers family with a 1940s shop, tucked away at the back of a modern delicatessen.
Morning. How are you this morning?
Shop owner Nigel Lovegrove will be their wartime shopkeeper.
You've got a selection from...
Lovegrove's will only stock products and produce that were available during the war. Michael and Kirsty are not just here to buy food. They also need to prepare their home against air raids. By law, each household had to black out all windows and doors at night. A chink of light could attract enemy aircraft and put a whole street at risk.
Have you had a chance to measure up the windows at all?
Not accurately, no. I've estimated 10 yards for them. Okay.
Basically, they used lining material and made up a frame, stretched the cloth over the frame, and then they would use some rabbit skin glue.
Right.
And some black pigment. Have you thought about your tape for taping up your windows?
As well as blacking out their windows, householders put tape on each pane of glass to prevent them shattering in a bomb blast. Government advice urged the head of each household to take responsibility for protecting his family. Just as in wartime, the Heimers have an air raid warden coming to inspect their blackout arrangements. They need to get going. Everyone dreaded bombs. Government estimates of the day predicted that one in every 25 city dwellers would be killed in air raids. Supplies of cardboard coffins were distributed to neighbourhood centres in readiness. At the same time, many homes were supplied with an Anderson shelter, named after the minister responsible for home security, Sir John Anderson.
Anderson shelter? Where'd you like it? That's the instructions.
Wow! This is what I've been waiting for. Yeah!
The family are excited about the prospect of having their own bomb shelter in the garden, but putting it together won't be quite so much fun.
Well, yeah, that is.
How to put up your Anderson shelter?
And look what's outside, a big lorry. Yes, check it out, Tom.
For weeks now, Michael, a 1940s enthusiast, has been telling his grandsons how he wants to build an Anderson shelter. It's been his dream since boyhood. But he'll have to pay £7 for the pleasure. That's more than his week's earnings. Anderson shelters were only free to those on low wages.
Well, my dad is so happy. Whether we'll be happy in two or three days when he's trying to build it.
You wait till it's full of water and you're sleeping on a sodden blanket.
I don't care, it's what you've always wanted.
Well, not so very long ago, on reaching home, I found a load of corrugated iron somebody left around. According to instructions of the safe, my worthy skin, the idea was to dig a hole and fit the sections in.
Something I've always wanted to do, build an Anderson shelter.
Keep fingers out, won't you?
Just to see what was involved and how much work was entailed. That's what I'm trying to do here. Dig it in properly, kit it out, and sleep in it. Must be mad.
So with the pick and shovel, I began to excavate for my shelter at the bottom of the garden. The neighbours gathered around and offered common sense advice, but my replies to some of them were not exactly nice. The ground was just like concrete and the shovel was antique. The pick went through a gas pipe and the gas began to leak. And when I called the plumber, his description was unique for my shelter at the bottom of the garden.
What it is, this, it's supposed to be a big pan of soup, which will last us a couple of days. What it actually is a big pan of grease. When I did the onions, I did them in lard. So when I put all the stock and everything in, and the onions, the lard's just made it this greasy mess.
I'm not used to manual labour.
Just washing my smalls. Well, my smalls, my father's large, you see how small it is. How small is that? Not very.
Oh, Dad, it's full of stone.
With all the excitement of building the shelter, the more urgent job of finishing the blackout has been delayed. An inspection by an air raid precautions or ARP warden is imminent.
I think somebody needs to write a letter to the ARP to ask if we can postpone tomorrow night's blackout check, because I won't get this done in time.
Well, let's give it another hour. And if you haven't finished the Anderson by then...
You mad bugger.
Oh. One penny to the swear box.
That's it. Catch it before it falls in the hole.
If we've got to dig five times more further down this hole, I'll be on my knees in a couple of hours, because I just can't do this. And Dad can't do it on his own. He might like to think he can. Thomas, it's not helping with you standing on the bit that I'm trying to dig. This is your fault, Dad.
I'm not even a foot down yet. You've got four of them to go. Well, three.
Three of what the depth it is now?
Yeah, three.
You've got to be joking, Dad. Yeah. I can't do this.
Well, I'll do it.
But you'll have a heart attack.
No, I won't.
Yes, you will.
It may take me a while, but I'll do it.
We're not going to be able to do this.
We are.
No, we're not.
We are. You've got to keep up the spirit that made England great. You couldn't just, in the wartime, sit back, posing on a heap of soil like a girly postcard and say, we're not going to be able to do this. We will do it. Skimmed all the fat off it. It's so disgusting. It's just a mass of salt. Because it was a bacon joint. But they're so salty. So as it's reduced, it's got saltier and saltier. And I have absolutely no idea what to do with it. Careful, it's hot, Tom.
It's salty.
Good God, Mum. No, don't eat it, children. It'll make them poorly. What I would say is it's awful. It's very, very salty. Yeah. It's like drinking, having a mouthwash or whatever you do with salt and water. Okay, so it's back to the old standby bread and jam.
Oh, honey.
Sorry about that, Matt.
Please let me pass my jam.
The blackout stuff is not going to get done.
The shelter is proving a bigger job than expected.
Okay. It's pointless just putting it up and leaving it on the surface so it won't stay properly.
When would the Anderson have had to be built by? You know about.
I don't know.
You don't?
It's got the blackout to finish.
I think you should postpone the blackout till Monday.
I think the blackout should be postponed. When Dad's finished digging in there, he's not one to come in here and start faffing about with the blackout. I think Michael's panicking a bit now. He's got what he's always wanted. He's got the blackout blinds to do and the Anderson to make, so pressure's back on. And as we keep pointing out to him, he wanted to live in the 1940s, so here he is. You can't realistically dig for several hours because none of us are fit. I would imagine people in 1940 were a lot fitter than we are now.
Wartime diarists recall how the job of building a shelter helped break down English reserve. Many had to call on their neighbours for help. The Heimers' 21st century neighbours are showing a bit of the old wartime spirit.
Here's an extra pair of hands.
We do really,
don't we? Not doing that, Ralph.
Yeah, we're going to dig.
Yeah.
Right, out. Shall we come through the garage?
Yeah. All right. We'll see you shortly.
Wait, look how far we've dug.
How can you be called a wimp digging this lot?
It's not something I would ask strangers to do.
I did feel that we did need help, although I do feel as though it's looked upon now as if we've sort of like cheated in a way. But then again, I'm of the opinion that in the wartime, neighbours would all help each other. I know, okay, the neighbour offered to come in and help my dad dig the hole. I think that's what they would have done in the war, and although he hasn't got an Anderson for us to return the favour and go, you know, build him, we could offer him something else, like perhaps vegetables out of our garden or something, and I'm sure that's what people did.
That's the rhubarb. That's all we've got ready in our garden, 3 pieces of rhubarb. So I'm hoping we've got some fruit left that I can mix with it, but hey, no, we haven't.
Just as she feared, Lynn is discovering that she's not a natural-born, old-fashioned cook, and pastry is definitely not her strong suit.
Just broken into pieces. What does that mean, Kirsty? It's too dry. It means you need more
water.
Water or butter or lard or something in it. I can't waste it. I've got to get it right. I mean, every 1940s housewife knew how to make basic pastry.
Everyone, especially the housewife, was expected to play a part in the war by exercising economy. To control the supply and distribution of food, a government minister of food was appointed. Lord Woolton took charge of Britain's wartime kitchens.
Good evening. It is to you, the housewives of Britain, that I want to talk tonight. We have a job to do together, you and I, an immensely important war job. And I'm going to be very practical and a bit personal, too. Now, don't tell me that you never waste a thing.
Sod it!
Let me ask you some questions.
Oh, God, we've nothing else to eat. I knew this would bloody happen.
What's that?
Get out! It's the whole of the tea. The crumble, all the peaches, all our rhubarb out there, lot, man.
On the floor?
All our flour, all our sugar. Everything gone. Oh, the tarts are going to get it as well. It must make you really cross, actually, spending all that time to drop it on the floor. I was really looking forward to that. There's absolutely nothing else for tea.
So is it jam and bread again for tea?
No, because I've used the jam.
Oh, we're going to have for tea, because we haven't got anything else. Not yet.
Yeah? We've dropped the tea. Right, the jam. Or with the flour over. No, because I've used the jam in the tart. It's our favourite. I'm just wondering if I can salvage the rhubarb.
You're not bringing that up off the floor.
Well, would you? Would you? If you were in war, proper wartime, that's take me all day to prepare.
Oh, no, I'm not eating it off the floor. You can't do this. We're going to have to swap roles.
I can sew.
There may be difficult days ahead of us. Far more difficult than we've seen yet. We shall still need feeding.
Do you want me to clear the floor for you?
No. Things are going to get tougher, and I just hope I can cope with it. We have to get organised, and especially as things start to go wrong, which I'm sure they will as the war progresses.
Beyond, I'm sorry.
We're not eating very well because, oh, we're living on bread and jam. The only proper meal that we've had today was probably our Weet-Bix. That's the only thing, apart from bread and jam, that we've had. And we nearly had to have bread and jam again because Granny spilled all the food and tea.
Yeah, but she did. Well, now we've got a casserole which is going to take forever to cook. And if it's
going to have tea at 9 o'clock at night.
It would be past my bedtime, wouldn't it?
I want to go home.
I don't want to go home.
Well, I do.
Worried the spring rains will flood the shelter, making it impossible for him to finish it, Michael carries on building, ignoring his deadline for the blackout inspection later today. Unlike her father, Kirsty is anxious that the family will be penalised if their blackout isn't complete.
I think we should fine them, actually, if they contravene blackout regulations. I think the social pressures are absolutely huge. People took the blackout very seriously. They thought that if a chink of light was showing or you lit a cigarette in the street, then you really were likely to bring the German bombs down on that particular area, that particular house. The enforcement of these regulations was draconian.
It's not just a matter of blacking out the windows. They have to make sure that every chink of light is stopped. And 80% of middle-class households during the first weeks of the war failed in this task. So it's a really testing operation.
Is your blackout really black? Can it be detected? Don't keep lying on your back. Go out and inspect it. Is your blackout really black? Have you drawn that curtain? Here's the warden on your track. It's better to be certain. Is your blackout black?
As we're starting to get more and more of the blackout material up at the windows, I am beginning to feel as though we're going to feel trapped in and penned in or whatever, and I don't know how women coped with it.
We've got a warden coming around in an hour and a half.
What time is it now?
Nearly 6 o'clock. And the house is not blacked out sufficiently.
Right.
I think it should be all hands on deck to get it blacked out because...
What, no, I've got to feed the children.
Well, coming up all hands on deck for half an hour. If the house isn't sufficiently blacked out, we're going to get really, really a hefty fine.
Kirsty wants you to come and do a blackout.
I think the three of us should concentrate on the blackout now.
Right. Well, I'll need to get changed.
In half an hour, then, we start blackout, and I'll get the tea on, your father will get change, which will make it 6:30.
Well, I'll just carry on, then, and do my best, but it won't all be blacked out. Can you manage?
I don't know.
I don't like it. It looks like a slum. I want to go home. It looks as if we're living in total squalor now. Can't make this pretty. It's just getting darker by the minute.
Go out
to the garden where it's light.
What time is it?
6:20, got an hour and 10 minutes.
It's been a hell of a day and it's all falling to pieces a bit now. I think Kirsty's had enough. Michael's absolutely exhausted. I've done a load of washing and I'm really tired.
Yeah.
I'm concerned about my family's health. My husband particularly is overweight and over 50. And he's had to work harder physically than he's had to work in a lot of years. And we're now waiting for a visit from the ARP lady.
Can you turn the light on, please?
It took months for Britain's wartime population to adapt to the oppression of living with the blackout. But the growing threat of bombers in the skies made them increasingly vigilant. In some cases, neighbours stoned the windows of homes persistently showing lights.
We haven't had time to do it properly, so we'll probably get a fine. And, oh, that sounds like the air raid patrol now. So it's icing on the cake time today, really. But, that's what we agreed to, this is what we agreed to do.
Our blackout inspector is Patricia Nolden, who, aged 17, was West Wickham's youngest air raid warden.
I guess we won't be smiling if you fine us.
I don't do the fining.
Oh, right.
But I might put your name forward to the police.
Reading one of the books, I made this frame.
Yeah.
So that I can just lift it down during the day and let the light
that's
in.
A
and
this. Good idea. Yes, most important that that's not going to get any light through any chinks, isn't
that
it? Because you need to be up here.
Yeah, that one's permanently painted.
Oh, so that's all right.
This is what I did.
Well, the brown paper sticky stuff.
Yeah.
Well, that looks very efficient.
What have you done about upstairs?
The same as downstairs.
It's the same.
It's the same arrangement in our bedroom.
Yes.
Yes, that's done.
Well, I think you'll get away with it.
The Hymers family have passed the test, for now.
We will keep an eye on you, of course.
Of course.
The hidden cost of blackout was the lives it lost. With streets also plunged into darkness, there were many tragic accidents. By Christmas 1939, over 4,000 people had died in road accidents, double the number that had occurred in peacetime. It's 10 days since the Hymers moved into the house. Now the War Cabinet have decided to accelerate their experience by advancing events to the start of 1940, 4 months into the war.
Lynn, where are you? Something come through about rationing. You need to fill all the ration books in before you go shopping.
Take the ration books to the shopkeeper. Have we got a ration book?
Got five ration books, you're supposed to have filled them in. Give me crap.
Been busy. This looks incredibly complicated.
I'm sure you can cope with it.
I don't understand it. The children have one for themselves?
Yeah.
So that's mine.
Then this is mine.
But who tells you how much you can have?
The government.
Well, where, how do I find that out?
From your shopkeeper.
On January the 8th, 1940, food rations began.
Rationing was introduced because food was beginning to get scarce, and it was recognised that it was probably only going to get worse, and certainly imports may become more difficult. The war was not going to be over quickly, and it was important to ensure that people had access to all the essential foods and that there was an even distribution across the country.
Yeah, but rationing, of course, was really popular. I mean, people petitioned the government in favour of rationing simply because it represented fairness in a people's war.
Is this bad news? Bad news in...
I'm afraid so.
Look at the shelves.
Please, 1 week. Not a lot left.
Oh, my goodness, look at the shelves.
It'll vary, I think, with as time goes on and more things become available, some things will disappear.
I just can't believe it's made so much difference to your shop.
All the vegetables now are basically homegrown. What we can get sourced from our local farms.
Can you see anything else?
Supply.
That's missing.
Sweets.
All the sweets have gone.
No, sorry, Thomas.
When will we be able to get sweets again, then?
No idea. What you've got there on that tray, I've measured out to what you're supposed to have
what
per
person.
What about
children, Mr. Lovegrove? Is that one adult's rations?
That is one set of rations per book. Unfortunately, along with the rationing, all the prices have jumped up. They've jumped up about 15%. And that's because it's so
scarce.
Well,
I have to tell you this. This is the first time I've done a proper list and a proper menu, all costed, and you haven't got any of it.
Unfortunately.
Cornflakes?
No. No cereals at all.
Well, we'd have cereals and more jam and bread.
You'll have to have some nice toast.
There's no jam, Thomas. Baked beans, yes.
Baked beans,
yes.
A few.
Three tins of baked beans, then, please.
I'd love to be able to do that, but I've got to.
Oh, they're rationed.
Well, I've got to think about all the other customers as well, so we're sort of putting it out slowly.
So, not only is what we can have rationed, what we really want's not here, and we can only have one of what we don't particularly want.
Well, what's
here,
you've got to bear in mind, what's here is in short supply as well.
It was a real shock when I walked into the shop. The shelves were more or less completely empty. If that had been a real situation, I think I'd have just burst into tears because it must have been horrendous for them. Unless I'm very inventive, and I'm sure I haven't got the skills that the ladies of the 1940s have, then my family are going to go hungry.
I don't think they're quite ready. They seem a bit hard and green to me, but I'll try them.
Bake it now.
Try it. I bet it's bitter.
Ah. I taste like soured grapes. They're not ready. They're not ready.
There's no OXO. I've got no stock cubes of any kind.
Oh, porridge.
Lynn's options in the kitchen are becoming limited. With no garden produce available yet, like the wartime housewife, she's going to have to be highly resourceful if she's going to feed her family.
This is leek and porridge oats and mushroom ketchup and Marmite with corned beef. How that'll work, I don't know. I have found a pastry recipe from the wartime cookbook, which is a no-fat pastry. I've also seen a recipe for potato pastry, so I'll try both of those tomorrow. Now I know what I've got to do, or I think I do till I get to the shop. Might all change tomorrow.
May a breakfast salad.
It's not
I'm truly not thinking about it.
As shortages increased, meals became more monotonous and portions smaller. The wartime diet begins to take effect on the Heimers within days.
What food have you missed, Tom?
I'm really, really hungry because there's really much less food. I think from the other members of the family, they're agreeing with me that there is less food.
The rationing on the food, I'm beginning to find it quite tough. In fact, I get quite emotional about it because the kids are coming to me every sort of hour, I'm hungry, can you give me something to eat? And I can't give them anything to eat because I haven't got anything. The children that are used to snacking in between meals and they can't do that here. What I don't want is the kids to suffer in any way. I mean, at the moment, I don't think they are doing. It's me having to learn to adapt to the idea that I can't always give them what I want.
It's taken a week of hard work, but the shelter is almost complete.
I'm sure we'll all be all right inside here once I get it kitted out and make some furniture. Ben will certainly like it. Thomas will like it because he'll see it as an adventure. Kirsty won't like it because she hates spiders and worms and things, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of them inside. And Lynn won't like it because it'll be dark and cold, and she won't be able to do her hair. I probably won't like it either. I don't relish the thought of using a bucket in a 6-foot confined space.
Ben, what's the first thing on the list?
Candles.
Should the worst happen, people at home were urged to prepare an emergency box to be kept handy by the back door. It was to contain all essential supplies.
Yes, that's candles. Toilet paper. Playing cards.
You don't need toilet paper.
Wow.
We're not doing stuff like that, are we?
Well, what happens if you caught short?
No way I'm dumping in a pocket.
You don't know that, do you?
I bloody do. I'd sooner take a chance with the bombs.
Possible. I'll get the toilet paper, Mum.
Just,
As the Anderson nears completion, I begin to wonder if we'll ever have an evening sat, relaxing. We'll never know when we have to get up, pack everything, grab the children and go.
We never know when it's going to go off, which is how people would have been in the war. And we don't actually know when it's ever going to go off. And, yeah, I do sit in the back and think, you know, what would, realistically, what would I do if the siren went off now? Would I put a towel around me and run out into the garden?
For the last 4 days and nights, London has been living a strange new life. By day, a life interrupted by short warnings and raids, and at night, long hours of waiting in the shelters.
We can take it. If he thinks he can win the war by bombing women and children, he's found a big mistake.
The noise that you hear at the moment is the sound of the air raid siren. I'm standing here just on the steps of St. Martin's in the Fields. A searchlight just burst into action off in the distance.
In wartime, sirens warned of impending air raids. It was a signal for people to rush to the nearest bomb shelter. The Heimers family have taken all possible precautions. The time has come to put their preparations to the test.
Thinking is that I have to get the children out and into the shelter. I was actually shaking and I managed to put the wrong dressing gown on the wrong child. I went on to autopilot and it was the strangest, most bizarre experience that I've ever, ever had. It was so, so real. I felt fear and I felt panic.
Top water bottle down.
All that mattered was to get my family safely into that shelter.
Right. Sorry, it's the camera smart,
isn't it? Right. Smart. I can't put a chair up in zero space.
Little kids have got up from a deep sleep and you're whinging about where to put the chair.
Bloody whinging.
You wanted to do this. You wanted to step back from 1940.
Yeah, great. I'm not complaining.
I don't. There's a proper leak there in the middle. It's raining a lot, you know.
Well, I haven't sealed it yet, have I?
Of course it hit home, how it must have been for the women who got their family into shelters. And if it shocked me, what must it have been like for those women? My heart goes out to them. I mean, it must have been absolutely horrendous.
People were grateful for their shelters. 57 consecutive nights of bombing occurred in London during what became known as the Blitz. And not just on central London. On the night of Friday the 13th of September 1940, a high explosive bomb landed on Braemar Gardens, destroying the two properties opposite the 1940s house.
I volunteered to do this. I feel terribly guilty. This is my fault. And I am having great difficulty watching my grandchildren almost crying with hunger.
War is really not a good game. It's a lot of hard work, especially for the elders. I wouldn't really like to give up my 2000 life to come back and live in the 1940s because I couldn't cope the whole of my life without food.
I think things are going to get harder. I think we're going to have more and more taken away from us. I find it hard when it's connected to the children.
I have. I have to be honest, sat here and thought, have I done the right thing? And, you know, bringing them here.
The Heimers have spent three long weeks finding out what home life was really like during World War II. They're now moving into the mid-war period. In early 1941, the focus of the war had moved, leaving Britain relatively quiet.
I need this letter.
Is it?
But to Mr. Nobody.
But the German bombers were never far away, so the blacking out of windows remained a vital defence.
Oh, no. ARP, Air Raid Patrol. It's been brought to our attention that certain irregularities have occurred in relation to your blackout. We have received two reports indicating the showing of light from 17 Braemar Gardens. First occurred last Friday evening when the back door of your property was left open and light left on in the kitchen. That's a bloody air raid. I mean, who cares about lights in the kitchen if your house is going to be bombed?
At a meeting in Winston Churchill's war rooms in central London, our wartime cabinet is in session. It's their job to impose the strict government regulations of the day on our family.
This is a major infringement. I mean, a great lighted window that might act as a beacon to German bombers. I mean, given that smokers in the street just striking a match to light a cigarette were prosecuted. So something got to be done.
It was, of course, just as much an offence to show a light at any time. It didn't have to be during an air raid warning. That perhaps made it particularly bad. But any time after blackout.
I think this is a question of certainly a £3 fine and perhaps a £5 fine at this stage.
It doesn't sound a lot, £3. If your wage was only £8 a week, puts it into perspective. It's only a true reflection of what happened, I suppose. You're told what to do a lot more than we are now.
I was really cross about the letter because I felt it was very petty. I was just trying to get my children out of the house safely. It didn't even occur to me to think that I had to turn all the lights on before I opened the door and get them out in the darkness.
Blackout was dangerous and caused hundreds of thousands of accidents in the home. Just a few streets away, a young mother fell down the stairs to her death as she was rushing to comfort her child in the darkness. As the war dragged on, families were required to make ever greater sacrifices.
Hey, bath! Hey, come on, bath!
Like so many husbands in wartime, Michael now has to leave. He's returning to work in the north of England. For the next few weeks, the women will have to cope on their own.
Darling.
Yes, my turtle dove.
Do you want to test the bunk?
You said, dressed like this, you were sorry, but I'm just not your Lynn, you said.
It's dark in here, I can pretend. I can close my eyes and think of England. Hello.
You seem as if you're more bothered about leaving your hands in some shelter than us.
Yeah.
My concerns about my dad going tomorrow is the fact that it's just me and my mother and we're going to have to cope with whatever. I mean, I've taken on the responsibility of trying to keep the boiler going. He's given me instructions on that, but I haven't actually yet managed to light the fire in it from scratch. I've just been trying to keep it going.
Children, right out of the way. The whole thing frightens me. The ash pan is too heavy, full of hot ashes, and I just think it's far too dangerous for us.
I live on my own, so I try not to rely on anybody, but I do know at the end of the day I can call upon my dad if, you know, I've got a problem or whatever. And so can my mum, but she's probably not looking forward to my dad going back.
Run rabbits!
See you in the morning. Okay?
Night, night.
Ask Ben.
Night, Tom. Night, Ben.
Night, night. This is my super duper notebook.
When you've gone, I'm going to become a lady who lunches.
What, are you going to go out and entertain you?
That's the closest you've been to my knickers for a long, long time.
Hardly inspired.
They're
one,
not mine,
look
at Kirsty's.
Huh? Is it?
They're not mine. They're not mine.
So be honest, chaps. Would that do it for you?
Now everyone has got to do their bit. And even our blackout is quite a hit. You'll never see a spot of light around the house at nights. We have no light refreshments now, no matter who invites.
Michael works for Precision Engineers making aircraft parts. Doing his bit in wartime would have meant working very long hours.
Well, can you see it from above?
Or as if I was a pilot.
Mm. Imagine you're flying over me now.
No.
Can you see it?
Industries like aviation were moved to safe areas in the countryside. If their employees didn't move with them, they could be fined or even imprisoned.
Blackout for a cigar. Point proven, I think.
I've lost it.
I bet I could have made a bloody fortune during the war selling these.
But, Dad, it was all a bit of a myth.
Doesn't that's the point, is it? You could get fined for smoking outdoors. Not with the Heimer's patented blackout cigar disguiser.
Lynn and Michael were teenage sweethearts. They've been together since she was 14.
Although Michael has been away and we have been separated on many occasions, we've never been out of phone contact. So that's going to be difficult. Very difficult.
That's it then.
Like thousands of wartime families, the Heimers are now facing life without the man of the house. Kirsty and Lynn have tough new challenges ahead.
Thursday. Bye, Tom. Bye, Ben.
Safe journey.
Bye.
Bye.
See
ya. I think it's going to be difficult, you know, just being me and my mother. And
as most people who know us know that we can be at each other, we can disagree quite a bit. I'll be very interested to see whether my daughter and I pull together and manage, or whether we'll pull separately and argue all the time. And I'm very, very apprehensive about it, very.
It's going out. It's going out. I need to shut that as well. It's going out, so I'm just going to have to let it go out and then I'm going to have to empty it all out again. Try again. Put loads of sticks and I've got a real blaze going. I've got a real blaze going and as soon as I put the stuff on, it just goes out. If I don't get this boiler working, then won't be able to wash up without boiling a kettle.
I'm going to stay here.
I definitely won't be able to have a bath. The children won't be able to have a bath. I'm not going to let it beat me. Giving up a step all night.
When they go out shopping, the women never know what they're going to find. On top of the shortages, there was soaring inflation. From 1939 to 1943, the cost of living in England rose by 83%.
Good morning, Mr. Lovegrove. This is looking a bit more interesting, a bit more full.
Lovely,
moreover, and nobody's told us.
To save wartime Britain from starvation, the US government began to send vital food supplies before they joined forces with the Allies.
We've got dried milk, dried eggs, dozen eggs, I think, equivalent to per box.
Many of these foods were processed to make the most of shipping space.
Spam. That basically stands for specially pressed American meats.
Now, this is where the new system of points rationing comes in.
That's right. The points system really allowed far more choice and flexibility in the range of foods that housewives could choose to buy. It was also a very clever system because by increasing the number of points you needed to purchase a particular food, government could discourage you from buying those foods which were in short supply, and by dropping the points could increase the likelihood of you purchasing those they had plenty of.
Yes, and it made it look as though there was more on the shelves when in fact the shortages were getting worse.
That's right, and from now on in, I think the family are going to have a pretty tough time of it.
We've actually written up the points on the products. For example, tin fruits, 8 points. Golden syrup, 4 points.
The weekly points allocation was 5 points per person, and this didn't get you very much.
Peas, 4 points.
I can see the sense of the points. It would be to stop people who have money buying up all the decent things in the shop. You know, so I suppose it was a fair thing so that everybody had the chance to buy certain goods. On the ration book. I can't understand why tinned foods, like 12 points, and I'm really miffed to find out why raisins and currants are sort of like 16 points, because every recipe I seem to come across for baking, you know, has raisins or currants in it.
So, basically, it's got even more complicated. I now not only have to sort out the rations, which, goodness knows, I've only just got used to, sort of, I've now got to sort out the points system, all this stuff that's coming from America I can only have every so often, and all this without a calculator.
It's taken Lynn and Kirsty almost an hour to do their shopping. With wartime queues, it usually took 4 times as long, and often housewives returned empty-handed.
Total war demands that all the strength of the nation shall be hurled against the enemy.
When my grandpa's away at work, I feel there needs to be another person in charge, another man, and I am the oldest male with my grandpa's away, and I am responsible.
The battle for fuel. It is a battle on the home front in which every man, woman and child in the country must play a part and do their duty. What you need are battle orders. In your papers this morning, you will see a message from the Minister of Fuel and Power.
I've never had a powerful power.
Yeah, it's exciting, isn't it?
Dear Ben, I'm writing to you as one of the Wartime House War Cabinet about the fuel savings campaign.
Ben has been given the job of fuel warden. From the tables in the papers, he has to calculate the family fuel target, the recommended allowance for a household their size.
Something that was widely recommended was putting a plimsoll line round the inside of a bath to save hot water. You need to run 5 inches of water into the bath, mark where it comes up to, and paint a line all around.
Paint. Ben's household tips. Never open a can of paint with tweezers. Or, a point for the factory owners, don't fill it too full. That's why. Just need to have a basic line going all the way around. As I've made a bit of a mess around here and put 2 lines, I'm going to write on the back of the bath, bottom line only.
Willful waves and sinful greed only make you thinner. One gas ring is all you need when you cook your dinner. Cabbages and cauliflower.
Because it was very hot yesterday, the milk's actually not very good. It's just about sour. The children won't drink it. We can't use it for cereal. I don't want to waste the milk. I don't want to throw it away. But it can't be used in anything else other than a sauce. I've also got some cheese that's gone a little bit mouldy, which under normal circumstances at home I would have thrown away. But
Now I can make this sort of rancid style cheese sauce.
Granny, hello? How long until tea time?
Pardon?
How long until tea time?
Dunno. To take things out when they're ready. I'm not following any recipes, so I can't give you time.
Being hungry is awful. Your stomach has this awful feeling of turning around inside you. It's a horrible feeling. And your throat completely dries up and you can hardly speak.
Granny, how many minutes?
I don't
know, Ben. Two. I'm the man of the house and I say it's going to be 2 minutes.
We're the men of the house.
You're not a man of the house.
I'm a man of the house. You're a child of the house.
I'm a boy of the house. Wimp of the house.
I'm not. Mummy Ben just owed me the wimp of the house.
Ben! You come in the kitchen?
Keen to stick to their wartime regime, the children volunteer to take packed lunches to school. But there's been a problem.
So, is this all you had?
Yes.
You haven't had anything else?
Yeah, there are my own sandwiches that I had.
And you've had your apple?
Yes.
And your flapjack?
Yes.
And your jam tart?
Yes.
And nothing else?
No. Nope.
Benjamin?
Nothing else out of my lunchbox.
Have you been eating other people's sandwiches?
Yes.
How many?
Half a butter sandwich and half of a ham sandwich.
I can't have people thinking that you're not getting enough food.
But I am getting enough food.
You'll have to leave it with me and I will sort it out.
I should send your brother in now because he's got something to tell Mummy.
Yes.
Do you think that's a bad wait for this one?
Thomas! Have you had your sandwiches today at school?
Yeah.
All of them?
Yeah.
Good.
Why?
Have you had anything else?
Yeah.
What?
A packet of crisps. 2 packets.
2 packets of crisps? Where have you got 2 packets of crisps from?
These friends.
So you've got friends coming into school bringing you things. I'm going to have to sort something out.
I don't know what junk it is, but I'm sure it's nutritious.
I'm going to have to sort something out, Mum. I'm not having people at their school thinking that I'm not giving my kids enough food and sending their kids in with extra food.
To stop the children eating their friends' packed lunches, Kirsty uses up precious rations to bake the boys a cake.
The rationing is starting to bite quite hard, and we are finding that there's a pecking order almost with the food. I'm certainly drinking more water and less tea or coffee so that the children can have the milk. The sweet ration, I think it's 2 ounces a week per person. We don't touch the sweets at all, the children have it. If we're lucky enough to be able to make a cake, Kirsty and I don't touch it at all.
Did they have any?
Are you just messing about with that, Tom?
Yes.
You can't waste paper like that.
You know?
No, you can't. It's the law, actually.
Is it?
Yes.
If you've eaten that chocolate, I will absolutely hit the roof.
Kirsty, I was hungry.
Have you eaten some chocolate cake?
Just a little.
Mum, I'll really go mad if you have. That's what I... Have you?
I'm not allowed to
this
eat anything.
This cake I've made for the children.
But I know, and everything's for the children, I understand that. But there comes a point where I have to eat more than just dried bread.
I know I've hit a bit of a raw nerve with this business about being so tight over the food, but...
Do you mean tight? I mean, it's just unbelievable. It's like parent abuse. I'm not allowed to eat anything.
You can have my milk ration.
You say that.
I won't have any milk.
I can have the biggest cigarette ration and then you smoke mine.
You're wrong. I am not smoking your cigarettes. I am smoking my Woodbines out of that
bag. Well, I wish your father was here because he would back me up on this.
I think you're being unfair. I said don't eat the chocolate cake. I'm not stopping you from having anything else.
Put a smidgen of butter on my bread and you stood over my shoulder. Is that butter?
Hang on. Whoa. My priority is my kids get enough to eat.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going out without things.
Yeah, but it goes down the line, doesn't it? At the end of the line is Thomas, who does without nothing for anybody, then Ben, then your father, then you, and then me. Nobody goes without to give me things.
You're making it sound as if I'm sat down and having a 3-course meal for my breakfast. I don't have anything. All I have put in my mouth today is 1.5 cheese sandwiches and that's it.
I've had apple peels and 2 slices of marmalade and bread.
I'm totally pissed off with it. The only thing that's keeping me here now is my children.
Oh, yeah. I think there's some rather turbulent times ahead for us.
Every day, Ben has to work out how many units of gas, electricity and coal the family uses.
Put in what I think we need for...
That's it?
Yes. I'm saying that. You have to cut down them.
He has to make sure they're keeping to their fuel target.
We used 12 units this week, and that's only from one day, which isn't very good, really.
And
why don't you give us to a bath at the same time?
Together, in
yeah.
the bath?
Yeah. That'll save water.
And it'll save water, and then you can add in.
No,
look at the colour of you. What makes you think that I want to get in your bath water? So we're only allowed to have 1 5-inch bath per night?
Yes.
No, per week.
Well, if you're having 5 per week, you only have 25 inches used, don't you?
He just sticks to it so rigidly. There's no give and take with the child.
I don't think there's any point being a fuel warden if no one's going to take any notice of you. My granny's been painting things on the bathroom wall saying fuel warden stinks.
There is no joy, believe me, there is no joy sat in 2 inches of bath water which is covered in scum because you've no soap, you've no bubble bath, you've no shampoo when somebody comes in and turns the lights out on you.
We need to keep under our fuel target.
Ben? Do you mean what the light's doing on? Bloody midnight, it's still fuel warning.
We've just got into trouble because the fuel warden has got up for a wee and we've just got into trouble because my bedroom light's been left on and we're not in there. So...
He's doing it in his sleep now. Fuel warning.
This is all we've got. She's going to probably make about, what, 4 cigarettes?
The shortages are now beginning to hit where they really hurt. With tobacco supplies fast running out, Lynn and Kirsty are reduced to rolling their own cigarettes.
I know it's something I should do. Stop smoking, that is. I just can't. And I can't at the moment without the modern patches, without... the availability of food or something to nibble on. And no, I'm not going to nibble on a carrot because I hate carrots.
Well, let's be realistic. You know, when I was pregnant with Thomas, I didn't stop smoking. If that didn't tell me to stop smoking, then nothing, a war, nothing is going to tell me that I've got to stop smoking.
There is a simple solution to the cigarette shortage problem. Let women stop smoking. If they give up the habit, their health would be better, and tobacco would be available for those for whom nature intended it. Our fighting men.
The forces got an enormous number of cigarettes, even if you didn't want them. I mean, I was a non-smoker in the forces and got a free ration.
The media, of course, were blaming women for this shortage of cigarettes. Women had smoked before the Second World War, but during the war, the incident rose hugely. In fact, by the end of the war, nearly half the women in the country were smoking.
All smokers suffered, of course, but women suffered worse because in some instances, shopkeepers wouldn't serve them.
In that case, I think the time has come for us to cut off the cigarette supply.
I'm dreading the day Mrs. Hymers comes in and asks for cigarettes, and I have to say I'm sorry we haven't got any, because I know for a fact I'm going to lose my legs on that day. Or something severe will definitely happen.
Good morning, Mrs. Hymers. What can I do for you this morning? Mr. Hymers, all right?
He's very well, thank you.
And the children?
Very well, thank you, Mr. Lovegrove. I'd like... what have we got? Anything? Yeah?
Everything that you can see.
All right. Some cigarettes. What?
Unfortunately, no, we haven't got any cigarettes. At this moment in time, we can't get hold of any. I promise you,
I talked to loads of old people, and the shopkeeper always had, they could always get a hold of me if it was only 10 cigarettes.
I know. Can I just serve my customer? We have 2 seconds. Oh, cool. I'll grab that phone. Hang on.
Yeah, get the phone.
Good morning, Crumbs. Speaking.
Right, well, let's just see how far this war is going to go, because... Right, so the cigarettes are gone?
Yes.
Check. Right, washing powder?
Washing powder. No washing powder at all.
No washing powder. Matches?
I'm trying. No matches.
Well, matches are no bloody good to us now, are they? Because we haven't got any cigarettes to light. Henna powder?
I've asked, but I haven't at the moment.
Grease blue paper?
I've asked, but I haven't at the moment.
Almond oil?
I've asked again, but I haven't got
olive
any.
Oil?
The same with the olive oil.
Corn flour?
I've asked, but I haven't got any as yet.
We are aware all the time of every single aspect of wartime economy. I have a tiny bit of cold cream left. I use it every other day, very sparingly. The toothpaste we keep in a little egg cup, which we let the children use because we know we can't get any more toothpaste. The adults use just water or salt and water, whichever they prefer. We don't use toothpaste at all. We don't have shampoo. We wash our hair in just water. And not as frequently as we would perhaps at home. The toilet roll, now at home we'd normally have probably 5 toilet rolls a week. Here we use 1 a week. And this is because we are constantly aware of the fact that paper is in short supply. The soap liquid that's left on and around the sink I would use to wash my hands with. The washing powder's now gone, and it's hard water, so you never sort of get anything other than scum. I haven't seen a bubble since I left home. I don't want to be in the 1940s anymore. I want to go home. I want to go home. I want to smoke cigarettes. I want to eat decent food and rest. That's what I want to do.
To add to the misery of having no cigarettes for the next few weeks, Kirsty has now dropped the lawnmower on her foot.
Let's try the cold compress, see if it fetches the...
With nearly half the nation's doctors and nurses on military duty, there was little medical help available for the folks back home.
If you just keep your leg up for, say, 20 minutes... I don't think there's much else we can do, really.
But my big toe, I just can't feel my... You know when something feels really numb?
Kirsty's bruises, though painful, should soon heal.
You know, as it went down...
I'm not saying I dropped it from a great height or whatever, but I dropped... It dropped.
Yeah, and then rolled.
We can't have them sitting around feeling sorry for themselves at a time when everyone was being urged to do their bit.
Absolutely. Well, what they could do, of course, is to do some voluntary work. I mean, over 1 million women joined the Women's Voluntary Service, the WVS. They escorted evacuees, they ran nurseries, they ran mobile canteens at bomb incidents. Don't forget, they really were in the front line during the Second World War. Nearly 250 members of the WVS were killed. Their motto was, if it needs doing, the WVS will do it.
Our wartime cabinet have decided that it's time for Lynn and Kirsty to do their bit for the war effort. They've been issued with the uniform of the Women's Voluntary Service, better known as the WVS.
Dear Mrs. Hymers, the Women's Voluntary Service was founded in 1938 to help with the war effort. Members of the local community will be in touch with you shortly to advise you of the jobs that we have chosen for you. I feel sick when I think about the work we're going to have to do in the voluntary services. These days, in the year 2000, you know exactly what you're going to do when you apply for a job. You know, to a certain extent, what the job entails. We have no conception whatsoever of what we're going to be asked to do in the voluntary services. And that makes me feel really apprehensive.
Lynn and Kirsty are to be given voluntary jobs, similar to those done in wartime by the Women's Voluntary Service.
Knock on the door, not the bell.
Hello.
Hello, my name's Siobhan Ross. I've come from St Mark's Nursery Group, and the Cabinet have given me your name as being interested in doing some voluntary work.
Oh, do you want to come through?
Yes.
OK.
If that's convenient. Come on in. I was just explaining to your daughter, I've come from St Mark's Nursery Group.
Oh.
Your name has been given to me by the Cabinet. They've said that you were interested in voluntary work. Can I interest you in coming to work at the nursery group? With either of you, I'd welcome any help whatsoever.
I'm quite happy to do that, but obviously I cannot give you a definite decision now at this present time about tomorrow.
Right.
Because I don't know how I'm going to feel in the morning.
No, that's all right.
But I'm quite happy to do that.
You're quite happy? Yeah. They're all fairly clean children. We haven't got any head lice at the moment, so...
The Homer's next visitor is a surviving member of the WVS.
Hello, you come in.
Thank you.
The Women's Voluntary Service still thrives today, 60 years after it was established.
It's best to lay them out a bit to make a pattern.
In addition to their voluntary work at the nursery, Lynn and Kirsty are also being given work to fill their precious free time at home. The wartime WVS volunteer used every spare minute to help those in need.
Keep those bits because they'll do to sew some of them together.
The crocheted squares are sewn together to make blankets for those in need. If this were wartime, Lynn and Kirsty would be sending their blankets to the troops.
Do you have to put a knot in it then?
No, no. You've done it long and then do it round there a little way.
So all these loose ends have to be sewn in first?
Yes.
Yeah.
The blankets that I've got to stitch together and sew, I mean, my sewing's not absolutely brilliant, but at the end of the day, it's going to keep somebody warm.
Is this the sort of thing that WVS would have done in the wartime?
Yes.
It is,
yes.
Make blankets for...
Blankets, then they were given to the people who were homeless and that sort of thing.
What other sort of things would they have made during the war?
There's a handbag I made.
During the war?
During the war.
Did you? Gosh, and you made it. That's amazing. Wonderful.
And I made these gloves.
Oh, they're lovely.
The wartime government was keen to promote the idea of make do and mend. They used a character called Mrs. So-and-so to encourage people to mend and patch their worn-out clothes. The Homer's wardrobe is suffering from wear and tear, and neither Kirsty or Lynn know where to start.
This T-shirt of one of the children's is sort of covered in holes. What's the best way of... down in mending that.
You can't do away with the pocket.
I could do, yeah. So you take the pocket off there and then...
If you take that off there and put it down there...
Now then, this is what I need your advice on. It's just rotten, and I just don't know what to do with it now. Because whatever I do, it's just...
Well, if it were mine...
You'd make it into a short sleeve nightie.
Yes.
Yeah, I can.
Shorten the sleeves. Cut it off and hem the bottom.
Yeah, easy.
Hello.
Hello. I'm from... been asked to call on you by the Cabinet Office to discuss some... voluntary work.
I'm your woman.
While the wartime WVS collected for families who'd been bombed out, Lynn and Kirsty will collect for the local charity shop, adding to their already heavy workload.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think you could collect the sacks? Have you got anything?
Well, my daughter's got a little truck for her bike, which you can't pull, so I don't know how that one will go, but I shall work around that one.
Mm-hmm.
We'll just do what we can for you.
Excellent.
That's all I can say at this moment in time.
Excellent.
Bye-bye, thank you. Who's going to go to Lovegrove? Who's going to take the kids to school? Who's going to do the washing? Who's going to do the 101 things that need doing in a 1940s house? Part of me wants to go home, part of me wants to stay and do better, because I feel that there's been some failure here. I've got to get into a more positive frame of mind, and at the moment I'm struggling with that.
Well, I think I'll frighten children. Look a bit stern, a bit strict.
Over 1,400 state nurseries were set up to free women for war work. A mother could leave her child before breakfast and collect it after supper, knowing that it would have balanced meals as well as free milk, juice and rosehip syrup. Women were encouraged to have more children and pregnant mothers were given extra rations. The birth rate went up by 22%. Some doctors even advised having babies as a cure for wartime anxiety.
I'm resisting it.
Outside the house, Lynn and Kirsty are exposed to the temptations of modern living.
And a cup of tea or coffee for you?
In wartime, this cake would have used all their points ration for at least 2 months. What's more, sugar was in such short supply that it was illegal for bakers to use icing.
My relationship with Kirsty has changed a great deal over the last week. Kirsty and I have always argued. Normally, I'm the stronger one, but the last week has sort of turned that on its head. Kirsty has become even stronger than she was before and has almost, in a sense, looked after me.
The turning point for me was when we had such a bad couple of days. We didn't have the cigarettes, and one thing or another, we both got very down. For the first time ever, my dad was not around for my mum. I felt like it was my place that I had to do something for my mum and for myself, and I felt as though I had to be the stronger person, and I just felt like we'll just go around in circles if somebody doesn't pull themselves together and sort things out.
Then we don't need to feel like complete failures, do we?
I think collecting the scope bags is a worthwhile experience because at the end of the day it is benefiting somebody else. I don't mind the hard physical work because women in the 40s would have done physical hard work.
During the war, 241 members died while on active duty. So whatever we are asked to do, we know that we have to do it because we'd be letting the WVS down.
Up in the morning early. The physical exercises for ladies.
Look to your looks. Beauty is definitely a duty. When you look your best, you feel self-confident, and your confidence transmits itself to those around you.
While beauty for duty became a popular wartime slogan, the challenge for women was to be beautiful without cosmetics.
I personally think 1940s woman would hang on to the makeup to the bitter end. Lipstick was supposed to be worn every day. It was called the Red Badge of Courage and worn throughout the war.
From 1941 onwards, it became virtually illegal to manufacture hair and beauty products. But this only encouraged women to turn to the black market. Even legitimate shops sold nail varnish disguised as ladder stop. In all aspects of beauty and feminine hygiene, the wartime woman had to improvise.
I have become desperate in the last few days because my white roots are showing through my hair, and I thought a vegetable dye would be the best way forward, so I'm finding all the things from the garden that I know create some sort of stain and really making it up as I go along.
It stinks.
How's it looking?
Dark.
Yeah? Or are you just saying that to make me happy?
No, it's... I don't really go out, it doesn't rain.
Oh, Kirsty! It's all over me! When I put on that uniform, I change. I become Mrs. Organised, Mrs. Wonderful, Mrs. Can cope with anything. Mrs. Will cope with anything. We'll push boundaries further. fond of this hat.
The uniform is doing for me what Prozac does for thousands of women in the year 2000.
Morale is up, and Lynn and Kirsty have decided they could be doing more for their war effort. They've decided they'd like to do something for those with first-hand experience of the war, so they're going to help out in a nearby retirement home.
I thought working with older people would actually be better for me because it would enable me to give something back to the wartime generation that did suffer so much. And I think they'll enjoy perhaps the uniform and to chat about what we're doing. And I will feel more useful and more really in keeping with what a WVS lady would have tried to do throughout the war.
Shortages are hurting, you know, there's no soap, shampoo.
That's why her hair's like this.
What did you use? I'm just water.
Oh no, just soap.
Well, or Lux Flakes.
Did you ever use Lux Flakes? No, we weren't.
Yeah, Lux Flakes on your hair.
We weren't that well off, it was soap.
I hope you're only having 5 inches of water in your bath.
Certainly are, we've got a black line round.
Oh, is that the tide mark?
We've got black lines round the black line, because there's nothing to clean the bath with.
When the older generation says to the younger generation that we're better off than they were, then I really do believe that. You know, having listened to some of the experiences and having to do some of the physical hard work that I've had to do, I have got a lot of admiration for the people that lived through the war.
When I'd cleared the plates from the dining tables, the food I was putting into the waste bin would have fed my family for a few days. But home in 2000, I'm the most wasteful woman in the world, but here, I can't bear to waste anything.
It was actually illegal to waste things. You were not supposed to throw away paper. Paper had to be reused, and it said that at the bottom of every magazine. You were not supposed to feed your pets anything that was possible for human consumption. And indeed, a Miss Bridget O'Sullivan in Barnet in Hertfordshire in 1942, she was fined £10 with 2 guineas costs for feeding bread to the birds.
As you can see, the national loaf is its usual fresh and spongy self, not.
Their loaf is bread made from national wheatmeal flour, which had calcium and vitamins added.
It is horrible. It is dry and it's got really, really hard crusts. And it's very grey. I also find it really difficult to keep it fresh.
The national loaf was so unpopular in its day, it became known as Hitler's secret weapon. The government was believed to have put out the rumour that it had aphrodisiac properties to encourage the nation to eat more.
Hang on. It's not right. The bread's not right. It's not just stale, it smells Faustian. I know it's not bad, but I'm hungry.
The impact of shortages went beyond food. Every day, household goods were also disappearing from the shelves.
Mr. Lovegrove, my grocer, thinks that the worst thing in the world that can happen to him is me going in his shop and him not being able to supply cigarettes. But I have to tell you, he's wrong. Because what he hasn't yet seen is me expecting important visitors and having no vim.
Marguerite Patton wrote to my mum and said she'd like to come for tea. As I've sort of adapted the role of being the baker, I've got to somehow make some nice cakes and nice things for her to eat, which is beginning to stress me out a little bit because I'm not quite sure what to make.
Kirsty has every reason to be anxious, as Marguerite Patton was the most famous cook of her day. She taught a nation how to make do with cunning recipes for mock apricot tarts and honey made from boiled parsley.
It's a nightmare. I've been awake all night. I'm really nervous. I've come out in a nervous rash. So, I mean, I am enjoying doing it, but I just, it's the thought of, you know, Margaret Patton eating my food. And it'll probably all turn out wrong and I'll probably burn it all. But if I burn it, I'll have to put that on a plate because I won't have anything else.
Under normal circumstances, I would clean this house and polish it from top to bottom if I was having such an important visitor as Marguerite. But because of the war work I'm doing, the priorities change, everything changes.
I'm making a chocolate cake and I'm using the children's eggs, which I normally save to keep them to make eggy bread. I feel incredibly guilty, but there you go.
Lynn's first priority is now her voluntary work, so Kirsty is left to do all the catering on her own. She's struggling to make do with what's available. The sausage meat doesn't look promising.
The sausage meat boiling in a pan look absolutely disgusting, and I really don't want to have to serve that to anybody.
At the nursing home that Lynn now visits daily, she's made friends with wartime fireman Reginald Long. Reg was keen for her to know of some of the unsung heroes of the home front.
I was on leave. It was my wedding anniversary. And they were killed on a Sunday night, you see. Of course, I go back Monday morning, and the wife had made a lovely cake for the boys at the station. And when I got to the gate, I knew there was something wrong, you see. And I said to Reginald, what's gone wrong? He said, something very serious. And I knew then. So, of course, the cake went home again.
And what had happened to your friends?
Well, they were at an assembly point, and you had to go to an assembly point, and then they dispatched the crews from that assembly point to wherever you were required. Well, this crew, there was about three crews there, and they got a direct hit, you see, before they were dispersed.
And how many were killed, Reg?
21. In one night, 21 Beckenham boys in one night.
What on earth have we got to complain about because we can't get milk or shampoo or soap or washing powder or cigarettes even? What does it matter? We don't have death. We don't have fear for our lives. So the least we can do is fulfil the other bits of it. We owe it to the people who did suffer and did struggle to do the best we can.
One of the most important jobs of work, both during and after an air raid, is blood transfusion, that miracle of healing that breathes new life into shattered bodies. Dr. W.S. Stanbury.
Here you can help. For in the county of Yorkshire, over 100,000 men and women are ready and willing to give their blood to save the life of a soldier, a sailor, an airman, or a loved one at home. Confident and assured that somewhere and someday their blood will serve Britain.
As a gesture of solidarity with those who gave so much to the war effort, Kirsty, like many of her wartime sisters, is going to give blood.
I was listening to the radio the other night with my mum, and there was a programme on asking people to come forward and give blood for their wounded soldiers and, you know, wounded civilians. And it just made me think that, you know, it was something that I'd like to do.
Do you donate from your left arm or your right arm?
Obviously not for the wounded soldiers or anything, but because today we, you know, still need blood, you know, for blood transfusions.
OK, have you had something to eat and drink tonight?
I have, yeah.
OK.
Did they ask you if you wanted anaesthetic or not?
They didn't ask me.
Do you?
I'm just going with the needle.
You sure?
Does it really, really hurt?
Depends on the person.
I do feel whatever we can do to help other people, we should do. I'm sure that was a big part of it during the war. You know, people did whatever they could to help other people. And if it was the difference between life and death, then surely they, you know, could spare some of their own blood.
Can I just press on there for me? Thank you.
I wouldn't have given blood a month ago. In fact, I probably wouldn't have even thought about it. I think doing this has made me more aware of other people's needs and, you know, what I can do to help other people, then I will try and do.
We've beaten our fuel target by 13 units, which is pretty good. And we beat it by 2 units, so that's like 15 units that we've saved. So that is quite a big achievement for me, really. And I'm pretty happy with it this week.
She's here!
When the family first arrived 7 weeks ago, it was Marguerite Patton who introduced the family to the 1940s house.
Well, I'm very much looking forward to seeing the family again. I liked them so much when I met them briefly, and I'm longing to hear how they're getting on, how they've met the challenge.
Hello, Lynn. How lovely to see you again.
Oh, honey.
And tomatoes.
You must be ready for a cup of tea after all your hard work.
Lovely. I say, haven't you been busy? Well, what a splendid spread.
I've made a dark chocolate cake and a sultana orange cake and some jam tarts.
Kirsty has produced an impressive spread for Marguerite, but she's had to empty the family larder to do it.
I've never, ever made a cake till I came to this house. In fact, I've never made as much as this in my entire life.
Well, isn't your mother clever?
Very.
And do tell me about these. They look absolutely fascinating.
Well, those are sausage, meat and apple. Mm. It was actually for sandwich filling, to make sandwiches, but I decided to make tarts with them.
I congratulate and raise my cup of tea in tribute to the both. You've done jolly well.
The war years were times of problems, but I think it gave many of us a chance to discover depths which we didn't know we had, talents we didn't know we had before. And I think both Kirsty and Lynn typifies how women cope. Kirsty's, who'd never baked much before, now has discovered this talent for baking, and Lynn has done sterling work, going to nursing homes and talking to old people. They have typified the way women cope during those war years. Pretty good sex we were. We managed beautifully.
I have to say, this is an interesting sort of journey for me, and perhaps for all of us. I'm finding my own strengths, I'm finding my own weaknesses, and it's changing me.
Yeah, we've had a lot of physical hard work and mental hard work, but at least we can say at the end of it that we did it.
I felt proud of my daughter for the way she coped with everything and the way she handled everything. Very proud, and that's a nice feeling for me as a mother, and I must remember to tell her.
The siren's going off. Yes, quick.
Coming up, as the war reaches its climax and bombing gets closer to home, life for the Heimers family in wartime Britain gets an awful lot worse.
It wasn't all happy la-di-da-di. Many men and women did lose their lives.
Then it gets better. Stay tuned for more of the 1940s house. Mm. Michael Hammers returns home for the final 2 weeks in the 1940s house. He's going to be working locally. While he's been away, the women have had a struggle, but they coped. Now he's back, they reckon they're better off without him.
Now my husband's home. My husband's home for the remainder of the war. He gets the best meal, the most pie, the most vegetables, the most milk, the most butter, as do the children.
Thanks, dear.
He doesn't realise that sacrifices have been made by myself and my daughter. We've gone without meat ration. We've probably had no butter on our bread.
We've tried everything.
He's no real conception of the shortages.
Michael has been keeping to his 1940s regime. But even in wartime, those who went out to work were generally better off than the women they left at home.
No, but joking apart, I don't feel guilty. I've done nothing.
Well, that's OK, then. You can watch the dinner pot.
No.
Why's that, though?
I don't do dishes. It's women's work.
In Churchill's war rooms in Whitehall, our wartime cabinet meet to decide how difficult the Hymers' life should be in their last year of war.
The women have had a pretty hard time of it up to now. I think we can afford to start taking the heat off them a bit.
Yes, I mean, there were far more supplies coming into the country, so I think we can relax a little and maybe allow them the odd luxury in orange or something.
And of course, just before D-Day, there were 1.6 million Americans in the country, and they cheered things up considerably.
They brought Glenn Miller records. They brought a whole wealth of things, not excluding contraceptives, which were quite useful too. So they added to the gaiety of the nation.
Thanks to the Americans, the Hymers are being allowed their first consignment of wartime treats.
Castle!
Oh,
no, not
from
right.
USA!
USA?
Look, it says...
Have you been somewhere and not told us? Has she, Michael?
I don't know.
From... You have been with a soldier, haven't you?
GIs stationed in Britain were generous with their gifts of nylons, food and cigarettes. They also encouraged the folks back home to send parcels.
Santa Rosa. Santa? It's from Santa?
No, Santa...
Santa Rosa.
Oh, you've got some new clothes, darling.
This might be for me.
Get them on.
Yeah, of course. So, what was his name? His name, then? And did you tell him you'd no buttons on your cardigans? And you didn't know how to sew them on. Dear Hymers family, you folks are in our prayers. We hope you are all right and your boys are doing okay. Here are a few things to help out. It's hard to imagine how hard your lives must be with all the shortages and the air raids. You are in our thoughts. The Cruitt family, isn't that kind of them? Vienna sausages! Chicken! We haven't had any chicken.
Pineapple!
America's greatest tonic to Britain's flagging wartime spirit, after her GIs, was her music.
The thing that strikes you about reading this magazine is it shows exactly why I think people thought America was fairyland and why English girls perceived the Americans to be all things wonderful, because it really is. It shows you this land of plenty. Here's the American advertisement of a happy family, father and daughter coming home from skiing or whatever, mother preparing the vegetable soup that's really delicious. And then we move to the British version where we're faced with a rather glum woman and an advertisement for Beecham's pills. Even if you had constipation, I think you'd rather have a bowl of soup than a Beecham's pill looking at her.
An estimated 44,000 British girls became GI brides. Roughly the same number married Canadians. We'll never know exactly how many GI babies were left behind. The guess is around 23,500.
BBC Home Service. Here is a special bulletin read by John Snag. D-Day has come. Early this morning, the Allies began the assault on the northwestern face of Hitler's European fortress.
This is the day, and this is the hour. June the 6th, 1944. The sky is lightning. Lightning over the coast of Europe as we go in.
D-Day, June the 6th, 1944, was a turning point in the war. The Allied forces began their invasion of Europe, landing on the beaches of northern France. BBC reporters on the ground used specially developed wax disc recorders to bring the invasion closer to those listening at home.
Red, white and blue parachutes fluttering down, and they're just about the best thing that we've seen.
20 million people tuned in.
The men who are sitting on the benches in the back of the glider are no doubt wondering whether the parachutists have succeeded in seizing the ground on which we're going to land.
In a moment you will hear the Supreme Commander, General Dwight D. Eisenhower.
People of Western Europe, I have this message for all of you. The hour of your liberation is approaching.
D-Day was the great climax. There was a feeling that once that had come, we would get across the Channel. The war would certainly be over by Christmas. And in fact, the Allied chiefs thought that it would be over by September.
When it looked as if the clouds of war were finally lifting, people began to relax for the first time in years. They'd been discouraged from going away on holiday, as what survived of public transport was needed for troops and food supplies.
Of His Majesty's government, the Beckenham Council has decided to arrange the Holidays at Home programme. We have endeavoured to cater for all tastes and ages, and given good weather, will provide first-rate entertainment and fun for the children.
Would you have done better with a bottle opener rather than a tin
opener? Oh.
The best thing about Holidays at Home was probably our picnic, because I've never been on a picnic my family before, and I really enjoyed it because we played games there. We had cherries and sandwiches.
You've done us really proud.
You can enjoy your leave all the more when you holiday at home, knowing that by refraining from travel, you're helping to speed the flow of the Allied services in the theatre of war.
As part of their holiday at home program, the Heimers traveled 7 miles to the neighboring suburb of Chislehurst to visit Chislehurst Caves. This vast network of abandoned mines became a refuge for city folk sheltering from Hitler's bombs.
I found Chislehurst Caves very interesting because I thought out of the whole experience it was the one thing that brought me the closest to how people in the 1940s really lived and how they felt.
Night after night, in the darkest hours of the war, 22 miles of dripping limestone caves became home to 15,000 Londoners. Chislehurst Caves tells the story of how the wartime generation pulled together. Here, a thriving community built its own hospital, concert hall, hairdressers, canteen, church, and even a cinema.
The long tunnels of the caves were used to just house bunks which were two or three tiers high, I believe.
A bit like mine, aren't they?
How did they keep the children occupied all night? How did they keep them quiet when there were several thousand people coming and going? How did they manage to get their sleep? How did they stop the children from being frightened?
When I went in that and I saw all that, I thought to myself I wouldn't have wanted to be living in the war.
It really did show the hardships of the 1940s housewife protecting her family. And I find that to be one of the greatest stories of the home front.
That's a Wellington!
Refer to things. There's the town.
Michael's priming the boys for the highlight of their holiday at home, a family outing to nearby Biggin Hill.
This bit finds a beautiful shape.
During the Battle of Britain, Biggin Hill was the most important operational fighter base. Now it plays host to an annual air display featuring planes from World War II. To keep the women happy, the last of the family clothing coupons have been spent on a utility suit for Kirsty. The government introduced utility designs to use what little material was available to maximum effect.
Not often I like 1940s clothes, but I really like that.
Yeah. There were even regulations that told you how many pockets and pleats you could have.
I love it. That's how it goes, definitely. Yeah.
Let me go look in a minute then.
Hats were never rationed, and covered hair badly in need of a wartime rarity is shampoo.
You won't have it like that.
Trust me, I'm a 1940s housewife.
I'm trying to get rid of the unwanted hair on my legs. Apparently in the war there's a razor blade shortage, so I haven't got a razor anyway, so even if I could get out some blades it'd be no good. So what apparently they did was used a pumice stone to get rid of the unwanted hair, which is what I'm doing now, and it's supposed to be a really well soaked pumice stone, but because our soap is rationed I can't really use our family's rationed of soap on my legs.
The shortages of war made it hard to replace worn-out clothes, so it was a real treat to dress up.
God, I look so immaculate. Hello, Hercule Poirot.
I have not got the wax head for my moustaches.
Shall I take this hat off?
Darling.
No,
it's cool.
Darling.
It's cool.
Darling,
go. Oh, let's
go. All I'm pleased about is I've got a long enough skirt on to cover my horrendous leg.
What's the matter?
I've got a long enough skirt on to cover my horrendous leg, look. Okay,
yes.
Well, shall
I
go then or what?
Michael's ordered a taxi for the big day out at Biggin Hill. It's only a 7-mile trip, but it's an extravagance that the family can barely afford.
I'm in what my family call Mrs. Miniver mode now, today. In other words, the idealised Hollywood version of a 40s housewife. No worries, no troubles, loads of dosh. Off I go.
Here's our taxi.
Driving for pleasure was not something people did in wartime, partly because most of the road signs had been removed to confuse enemy spies. With petrol shortages, wartime cabbies had to struggle to make a living. Yet there was an unwritten rule that no pilot was ever charged the fare to Biggin Hill.
Ah, look at that spit go up. Corsair on
In wartime, families would gather daily to watch the fighter squadrons take off.
Look at them as they come in from left to right, ladies and gentlemen. Over there to your left. Here they come.
I first became interested in Spitfires as a teenager. I used to watch old war films. Ever since then, I've just thought it's an absolutely amazing machine.
Put your ear in there. There you go. That goes like that.
Chops away, Tommy, chops away.
Goggles. How's that?
When we got close to the Spitfire, I could see that every bit of my husband's body was moving. He just wanted to get in that plane so much, and he didn't think he would be allowed to.
Put your foot down there and just sit yourself in. That's it. Why have the rudder pedals got two sets of grips? Was that just different?
Yeah, that's a good question, because normally you have your feet where you've got them now.
Yeah.
And what happened is, during the war, when you were pulling G, they found that if you put your feet on the higher pedals, your knees were higher, so you could take more G.
After winning the crucial Battle of Britain, Spitfires became the national emblem of victory. Housewives gave up their saucepans to build more of them. For as long as there were Spitfires in the skies, people at home felt Britain was safe.
These are the men from the Air Force. Yesterday, when we were sat in the Spitfires, well, these are the graves of some pilots who flew Spitfires and got killed.
When my grandpa took me to the graveyard to see the pilots' graves, I noticed that some of the pilots were very, very young. One of them was just 8 years older than me, 18. Obviously not very old, can't have lived much of a life. It wasn't all happy lardy-dardy. Many men and women did lose their lives during the war.
The siren's going off! Yes, quick!
By the summer of 1944, the people of Britain thought the end of the war was in sight. But then, on the 13th of June, 7 days after D-Day, the Germans began a new and unexpected assault on the home front. To give our family an impression of life in the era of the flying bomb, their shelter has been wired for sound.
Cutting out.
What do you mean?
Petrol engine, and then it just stopped. Listen. There.
Crumbs!
Then you wait for the bang.
There were 12 seconds.
8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Known as doodlebugs for the noise they made, 8,000 V-1 flying bombs were launched on London in 1944. At the height of the attack, they damaged or destroyed 20,000 homes in a day. Over the course of 3 months, these forerunners of the modern cruise missiles seriously injured 18,000 people, and a further 6,200 men, women, and children were killed. With flying bombs wreaking havoc across London and southern England, there was urgent need to increase the labour force. Now our cabinet recruit Kirsty. By 1944, 85% of women were out doing some form of work to contribute to the war effort.
Waiting with bated breath.
Do you want me to read it to you?
Please.
Many wartime women, including mothers, made a vital contribution to the war effort by taking on work outside of the home. We have made arrangements for you to start work at the Aero Engine Maintenance Company, Cobb Aircraft, based at Biggin Hill Airport. We wish you well with your employment.
By this time, because of the shortage of labour, the government was wanting to bring in women of all ages into the labour market. There was even something called the granny's call-up, which meant that women up to 50 could be so directed.
Of course, Kirsty, as a mother with two children under 14, would have been classified as an immobile woman, and she would not have been compelled to go out to work. But of course, on the other hand, there was tremendous pressure for women to work during the war, and with Lynn at home able to look after the children, I think that she would have been, by this time, anxious to get out of the house and, of course, earn some money.
Oh, shoes. A bell.
With Michael at the office and Kirsty now at the factory, Lynn is going to be left to run the household entirely on her own.
I was actually devastated. I'm very angry because I thought, oh, well, here we go, this is more work for me to do. Even now I've got to take on board the jobs that Kirsty did around the house and I've got to pick up the children from school. How can I possibly do all those things as well as what I'm doing already? Because I feel if I get 5 hours sleep a night, I'm lucky. And I feel, God, I can't do any more. A word, dear.
Pardon?
A word.
What?
What do you mean, what?
What?
So I'm supposed to take the children to school, pick them up, and do all the shopping every day. How can she? She can't. She's working till 4 o'clock.
Well, if she doesn't arrange something about the children, she doesn't.
What do you mean?
To see what her arrangements are for the children.
What about the shopping?
And the shopping.
Well, there are no arrangements that can be made other than me doing it. But hey, no change there then.
What?
Me doing everything. If you laugh, you're finished.
I'm not.
I think you are.
No, I'm not, only because you said so.
No, I could tell that you were wanting to laugh.
No. Not I.
Seems strange going out to work after having been here for sort of 7 weeks and I've got used to being around the home and doing things around the home. So it must have been really strange for the women in the 40s going off and doing what was considered, you know, men's jobs. And I would imagine they probably found it hard work. But I suppose, like everything, they got used to it and accepted it. See you later.
Bye.
Bye. See ya.
Before the war, legislation kept married women out of many jobs, but now they were being encouraged to work. Those with husbands on reduced wartime pay were glad of the extra income.
I can understand that women during the war who would have gone out to work, once they'd got that opportunity, obviously wouldn't want to let it go, and be it voluntary or paid work, I think it gave women independence because, you know, they got out there and I suppose, in a way, it gave them another purpose than just being a wife and a mother.
I'm really pleased that Kirsty has now got a proper job. At first, I was horrified. I thought, oh, gosh, how will I cope with all the extra jobs that I'll have to do. But in actual fact, it's worked out that it's harder work for me, but in a way it's better, because it seems to me in this war that the more you do, the more you can do, and every day I seem to be able to take on board more.
In the restoration workshop at Cobb Aviation, Kirsty is working on a plane built in 1944. Its wooden frame was originally put together in a furniture factory, which had been requisitioned for war work.
When I first arrived here, it felt very strange being surrounded by, you know, by males and no other women here. I mean, that's the first time in a job situation that I've found myself in that position, because most of the jobs I've had, you know, there have been other women around. I found that difficult, but I suppose women then would have got used to it.
Women worked alongside men, but they rarely got equal pay and there was no compensation for injuries. The average weekly wage for a man was around $6, and for a woman, $4.10.
I can't help wondering how Kirsty's getting on at work, whether it'll be hard, easy. Will it be as hard as this? Probably yes, probably a factory will be quite hard. I just hope it's good for her, and I hope it does her good, and I hope it makes her feel that she's doing something rather worthwhile, because that's always nice. I mean, housework's not exactly worthwhile, is it? But a job in an aircraft factory, that's something to be proud of.
It wasn't all fun working in aircraft factories. When demand was at its height, women worked 16 hours a day, 7 days a week.
If I'm finding it tough now and I'm doing shorter hours, they must have found it difficult having to go back home and do the jobs you would have been doing during the day. I don't actually know where they got their extra energy from.
On top of the housework, Lynn has kept up her commitment to the Women's Voluntary Service. She's helping out in a nearby retirement home.
They did so many jobs, the people on the home front. There was no stress counselling. They hadn't time to have stress counselling, they just had to get on with it. As I've had to get on with it.
Have you done this before?
No. No, it's hard work in the WVS.
Look at the corns. My very good friend and neighbour, Mrs. Tilling, was telling me that when I was saying how bad my feet were, she said, well, that's how it was. You really are doing the wartime experience, because during the war, not only had you to be on your feet for a lot longer, but you couldn't get new shoes. And if you did get new shoes, you had to take any old size going to make sure that you had shoes. So they might not even fit you or be your size. So feet were a constant problem to women in the war.
By the end of June 1944, West Wickham, the London suburb that's home to our wartime family, was getting up to 17 air raid warnings a day.
Phase of air raids because of the doodlebug, and they tend to be earlier than last time, sort of air raids that we're having, quite rapid succession. But the ones that come at tea time I do find very, very difficult, because you've had a hard day at work, and by the time you sort of get the evening meal on the table, the last thing you really want to do is dash out with it to an Anderson shelter, but that's what we had to do last night. When the All Clear went, I managed to go in and throw out this awful, awful cold dinner onto the plates, which the children had very quickly. But I didn't manage to get any pudding. The siren went again. So the kids were quite unhappy with it last night because they were tired and we were tired. But that's how it must have been. And
It really does make you realise how it must have been without the bombs. I mean, we can't possibly begin to imagine how bad that must have been. But just the pure disruption on your life when you are so physically tired. I mean, I've never been this physically tired in my life.
And the other thing about sleep deprivation was that it can do strange things to the mind. Hallucinations, palpitations, all sorts of things. I am so, so tired. Sometimes I really feel as if I'm in this war, if I'm there for real.
Locking up, Kirsty. No, but one of you needs to.
I'm going to put the kettle on, Kirsty, and I'm going to put my dinky clips in. Oh, not. Rachel, is he still on the toilet?
I'm going to sleep.
As if the doodlebugs weren't bad enough, in September 44, the Germans launched an even more terrifying weapon. Built like a modern space rocket, the V-2 travelled at four times the speed of sound. So fast you couldn't hear it coming. As in wartime, the all-clear siren indicates that it's now safe to leave the shelter. For the family, who've had an uncomfortable night, things are about to get worse.
Oh, no. Michael, will you come out of the Anderson, please, and get this sorted?
Our cabinet has decided it's time to bring the war a little closer to home.
Oh, no, 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 no. I want your Grandpa Mick and... No gas. Of course no gas.
Light a stove. Could light a stove.
Better get a what no gas sign made.
The bomb that created this mess might have landed a mile away. It's cut off the family's gas and water supply. Cleaning up after V-bombs became a daily chore.
I think that the cause of all this is probably because we heard big explosions during the night, so it's a long silence when nobody spoke, and then came up with, then there was another one, but I fell asleep after that, so I don't know if there was any more. But I think that was probably it. I think there were V2s because they came so silently.
The water's gone now.
By this stage in the war, after 5 years of conflict, over 55,000 Britons had been killed on the home front.
Right. It's rally round time, I think. Get everything in perspective. We're all still here. We're all still alive. We're not in any real danger, are we?
What's there?
Oh, damn, I can't make any milk.
I feel confused, I feel upset. But really, probably I just feel like every other woman did in Britain, seeing their nice things ruined. That's how I feel.
There was concern that the V2s would destroy public morale, so the government encouraged the rumour that they were gas mains exploding.
We're supposed to carry on sweeping the floor, but then you see you really need to mop it.
I'd always understood that a cup of tea fixed everything in the war, so that was my first concern, was to get a cup of tea going.
Tastes tinny.
Tea's going to have to be cold tea.
What do you want me to do?
It doesn't matter, because your father and I'll be dead soon. Drinking this.
Together to get this stuff cleared?
Yeah.
Or is, you know, your Spitfire really that important?
The worst bit about all this is, as you know, I'm no stranger to cleaning. You have to keep going all day and all night. Even though I've had very little sleep, I can do it. But without water, I can't clean. And I can't do hard physical work for hours without a drink. So the worst thing is the water, without a shadow of a doubt.
To rescue his family from their current predicament, Thomas has decided to open a cafe. It too has its problems.
But I don't know about tea and coffee.
Oh. Tea and coffee off.
The children have shone throughout this experience, because when it's all been falling apart for the grown-ups, the children have carried on. They've accepted all the hardships and shortages. But, of course, children don't care if there's no soap or shampoo, do they? They don't even care if there's no toilet roll. You know, the kids have just had a wonderful, wonderful time.
Wartime children had more freedom to roam than children today, but this could lead to tragedy. In March 1945, local boys were collecting bomb debris in a nearby field. Four were killed when one of their trophies exploded.
New horrors of war are coming to light as our forces advance further into Germany. From Belsen concentration camp, Richard Dimbleby has this report.
I've seen many terrible sights in the last 5 years, but nothing approaching Belsen. In the last few months alone, 30,000 prisoners have been killed off or allowed to die. Those are the simple, horrible facts of Belsen. Beyond the barrier was a whirling cloud of dust. The dust of thousands of slowly moving people, laden in itself with the deadly typhus germ. And with the dust was a smell, sickly and thick, the smell of death and decay, of corruption and filth. I passed through the barrier and found myself in the world of a nightmare. Dead bodies, some of them in decay, lay strewn about the road and along the rutted tracks. I picked my way over corpse after corpse in the gloom until I heard one voice that rose above the gentle, undulating moaning. I found a girl. She was a living skeleton. Impossible to gauge her age, for she had practically no hair left on her head, and her face was only a yellow parchment sheet with two holes in it for eyes. She was stretching out her stick of an arm and gasping something. It was English, English, medicine, medicine. And she was trying to cry, but had not enough strength.
I don't suppose my generation will ever know the full trauma of war and the effects on people's minds, because how can we know?
Tomorrow is V-Day plus one and is also a public holiday. No, but I'll tell you what we can do.
What?
Let the blackout down, can't we?
It's a happy, happy, happy day. For you and me, for us and we. All the clouds have rolled away. It's a happy, happy, happy day. The sun shines.
Look, it's ready.
As more reports came through of hardships suffered on the continent, British families sacrificed their own meagre supplies to feed the starving of Europe. With only a day to go, Kirsty shows the boys where she's been working. When the war was over, women were expected to give up their jobs and go back home, a move that was not always welcome. In 1945, the divorce rate was over three times higher than the pre-war figure, but the female suicide rate had fallen by a third.
I'm not bringing your washing in. If you want clean underwear for the morning, you best bring it in.
For their Victory Day celebrations, the family are going to a dance organised by a local 1940s society that regularly holds wartime events.
I'm certainly not jitterbugging, so please don't put me in the embarrassing situation of asking me.
No?
I'll be the only person in the whole bloody place with knickers like these on.
That's what you would have worn.
And the minute I go under, the knickers show. I won't be the laughing stock.
If I twirled you slowly, you wouldn't see your knickers.
Well, sit down, you can see my knickers. It's ridiculous, ludicrous that you haven't bought me 1940s knickers.
It's not through lack of funds. We've got no clothing coupons.
The war was over, but rationing wasn't. Shortages continued for a further 9 years.
They're quite pretty, though, aren't they?
Well, you bloody wear them.
I'm joking, even I couldn't fill them. That can't be for real.
Initially, I was apprehensive about going to the dance. We'd had such an austere time here that The thought of letting your hair down and enjoying yourself seems somehow wrong to me. However, it occurred to me that I was wrong. Why not let your hair down if you got the chance?
At wartime revival dances like these, modern-day Brits still pay tribute to their American allies.
People would have had mixed feelings on VE Day, probably. A way of life for the last 6 years would have been coming to an end. If you take the example of a Spitfire pilot, for instance, to be in charge of a machine like that, with all the freedom of the air and all that power to being stood down and not being able to fly, that must have been quite awful.
Mixed feelings about going back to my previous life. I mean, one of the things that, you know, I did find difficult doing this experience is that I was not in control of what was going to happen to my life, and somebody else was controlling what I was going to be doing. But I've learned to accept that. Now I've got to go back to making my own decisions. Something that I've learnt whilst I've been here, that I think as a modern family we are given too much choice. It certainly made me realise that when it comes to like the children, all the material things that they've got at home, they don't need.
I personally feel healthier after having spent this time in the house and in the garden. And I think that's mainly due to the physical work that I've been doing.
I just feel very privileged, actually, to have lived through this. Some of the values that our parents or our grandparents held dear to are actually, I've now found, very important values. So I don't know that having all the trappings of modern life makes it a better life. I don't think it does. About 17 Braemar Gardens that I miss. I particularly miss the Anderson shelter, because in the Anderson shelter we've laughed, we've cried, we've argued, but above all, it's pulled us closer together.
It's an odd feeling to have come through all of the bad times and we're leaving just when we would be celebrating. And I don't particularly want to celebrate because I don't want to leave.
Six months after their mock war, the Hymers are back at home in the north of England. We've come to see how the experience has affected their lives.
As a family, I do think from coming back from the 1940s experience, we have all changed. I think myself and the children have got more confidence.
I am a single mum and my husband left me, and that affected me for
you know, quite a while, it's still something in me that I do lack in confidence.
Yeah! Kirsty, she has changed. She's become far, far more independent. She's her own woman. She's her own family unit. She seems to be coping with anything life throws at her at the moment. It's been very good for Kirsty.
I think the 1946 experience was good for the boys because the minds were more stimulated there. There was no television or PlayStation games.
At the Earth, Ben.
I think Ben and Thomas could still live without the television and the PlayStation.
On PlayStation games, you seem to get bored with them because you can't rearrange them because they're on a computer. If you make your own games, you can rearrange it so you don't get bored.
Right, should we close the hatch so we've got more room?
1940s house, they hardly ever argued and they did play together.
We argued less in the 1940s. We don't know why, I just think it was probably because there was less to argue over.
Mm.
Because normal thing if we argue over is who gets to go on the PlayStation, who, silly stuff like Tom taking my things, because we didn't have any. Tom couldn't take anything.
But
we didn't have a PlayStation to argue over.
We shared them all, so there's nothing to take, really. It was half as yours and half as mine.
The children, in general, have become less demanding, I would think, in everything, in sort of, you know, buying things and wanting things. They appreciate the things that they've got now, rather than constantly wanting more things all the time.
Bye.
Since they've been back, Michael and the boys have maintained their wartime habit of creating their own amusements out of nothing.
Dude's Bug Alley is a board game that we invented after the 1940s, and it's basically just the Spitfires trying to protect London and the Doodlebugs trying to get through to get to London. We did a map of West Wickham because they had to fly over West Wickham to get to London.
The point.
It's sort of like Drafts, but with a different background.
Oh, yes, just in time.
While I was in the 1940s house, I'd rediscovered the joy of writing. And as I wrote more and more letters and wrote a diary, I found that words and phrases were coming back to me, whereas prior to that, and I couldn't string a sentence together some days, which I believe to be either advancing years or the menopause, but the reality was I wasn't using language to its full extent. I think letters are almost a form of a therapy, because as you're writing, you're actually thinking about what you're saying, you're thinking about what you feel, whereas on a phone call it's easy to just glibly say, yeah, I'm fine, yeah, things great. There's more truth somehow in a letter than in a telephone call.
Before the 1940s, my mum would go out, you could go have a drink with her, a few bottles of beer, she'd spend loads of money on clothes, food, anything. Now, she's totally different.
Lynn's experience as a wartime housewife has stayed with her. She rarely uses her car and no longer goes to the supermarket. She is now a regular at her local greengrocers, butchers and bakers.
The biggest impact that the wartime experience has had on my current day living is that it's saving me so much money.
Good morning.
Come on, can I help you?
Can I have £2 of mince, please?
Pleasure.
I save money on the petrol. I save money by buying fresh produce instead of pre-packaged. I buy all my food fresh daily from local shops, not supermarkets. One of the things that was very important to me throughout the wartime experience was my grocer, Mr. Lovegrove. He was a port in a storm. If my circumstances were different and I was perhaps on my own or elderly, then
It would almost be a lifeline, the local shopkeeper, and I do feel very strongly that I must champion the cause of the local shopkeeper, not only from a social point of view, but because I found it to be cheaper.
A comparison of Lynn's weekly shopping expenses both before and after her 1940s experience shows a dramatic change.
Today, for the first time, I've actually sat down and compared my pre-war budget, my wartime budget, and my post-war budget. And I have to say, I'm absolutely shocked. I've looked through my bank statements from before the war, which have all my shopping bills on. I've reduced the food bills by more than 50%.
Before the 1940s, she didn't behave like a normal, she behaved like a... She was cool. She was a lewd. And it's weird, because we were used to the granny that's cool and trendy and goes around drinking Budweiser and everything. But now she's gone into this old nanny mode.
It's not fastened at the bottom.
For all their new domestic economies, Lynn and Michael have had one major extravagance. They've acquired a garage, like the one they had in the 1940s house. Unlike that garage, this one has a car in it, a Ford Prefect.
It's a 1949 Ford Prefect that we saw advertised locally, and I think both realised as soon as we saw it that we had to have it. It just seemed to be the perfect vehicle for us.
I was looking forward to Grandpa getting this really new snazzy car convertible, big Mercedes Benz. But no, Grandpa goes and buys his old chug along, which you have to wind up to go anyway.
Peter the Prefect represents for me the happy and joyous parts of the 1940s experience. The picnics and the good times we had as a family.
Since we came back from the 1940s house, life is better. And we do lots of things like own picnics and out of theatres.
I think it's brought us closer together because we weren't known for arguments, whereas we do tend to listen to each other more.
Apart from making Granny go bonkers, the 1940s experience has made her more relaxed.
We'll meet again. Don't know where. Don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny
The 1940s House was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.